However, in the year 2013, 150 experts from 50 countries are meeting in Berlin to discuss anti-terror measures. Spirits are high at the closing reception. The workshop completed a draft convention on biological safety for the UN. Delegates will be returning home the next day, including virologist James Baldwin from New York and German medical student Sami Mahala, who's waitressing at this reception. As delegates discuss plans to neutralize such attacks, bioterrorists strike, of all places, at this conference. The cloth napkins on the buffet are contaminated with an invisible dust of smallpox viruses.
You might be the smartest person here.
Not as smart as you are. Where are you from?
From New York. I'm a virologist. What about you?
Smallpox viruses are officially eradicated worldwide, but their destruction in labs around the world was never monitored. The Robert Koch Institute in Berlin, which regularly stages such scenarios, is not the only institution that believes a smallpox virus attack is feasible.
Of course, you can be very scared of a bioterrorist threat, meaning terrorists not using aeroplanes to fly into Twin Towers, but actually use a virus or a bacterium to actually target the population. And actually, if it is a virus that will be spreading, for instance, like smallpox virus, an influenza pandemic, influenza virus, well, you can dream up a lot of things. We have made a long list of things that we may be and should be scared of.
Let's say we had a switch on the wall, and you could flip that switch, and suddenly every virus on the planet would disappear. Would you choose to flip that switch? And I think there's a first instinct for many people, like, oh yeah, I would absolutely flip that switch. But I think we would flip that switch at our own peril, because these are such fundamental features of our living planet and serve so many positive functions too.
Auf der einen Seite.
On the one hand, I look at a virus and think, how beautiful, what tremendous intelligence is in this tiny genome. Look how it gets into the cell, what clever things it does there in order to kill it. Phenomenal. And on the other hand, with the polio virus, I think of a fellow student in Göttingen who was killed by the polio virus in just 1 week. Back in 2002, the general public only had one thought on its mind. For heaven's sake, now that Wimmer and his group have shown the world how to create a virus, Bin Laden will co-opt it immediately, create really terrible viruses and kill us all.
I am totally convinced that 20 years from now you will be able to order bits and pieces of dangerous viruses like smallpox off the internet and artificially manufacture them.
It is theoretically possible to take the sequences and build them, but it's also practically in the laboratory tricky. You need a good lab and a good scientist. Sure, it's possible. It's been done, but it's why not just get it in nature?
Xavier Pourous specializes in a weapons-grade enemy, hemorrhagic fever. Its pathogens like Ebola or Marburg cause their victims to bleed to death internally. At the medical research unit in Gabon, where the French veterinarian works, they recently discovered that two of these killer viruses lie dormant in African bats without making the flying creatures ill. Since discovering this, Xavier is on the hunt for bats. Time and again, Ebola jumps to primates, including humans.
Thank you.
Perhaps the secret to a vaccine is concealed in the bat's blood. Currently, there is no cure for Ebola. That's not the only reason it would make an interesting bioweapon.
Up there are also bats, and it looks like there, in that small hollow, there are also rosette fruit bats, and the really large ones. You can see them quite well.
So far, Ebola only strikes in remote areas of Africa. So far, it kills its victims too quickly to spread further afield. But at some point, the outbreaks will reach Africa's big cities. In just a few hours by plane, they could then reach Europe.
There are many myths surrounding the Ebola and Marburg viruses because of their lethality and their clinical manifestation, the internal bleeding. With smallpox, on the other hand, we know that it has essentially been eradicated, but that certain nations have experimented with its use as a bioweapon.
Ten days after the bioterror conference in Berlin, medical student Sami Mahali is showing initial symptoms. Today, she's taking the most important exam of the semester. Together with her boyfriend, Lucas Schmidt, she had been preparing for weeks. But a defensive battle is raging in her body against variola major, the pathogen that causes smallpox. The virus entered her bloodstream through the mucous membranes of her mouth, nose, or eyes, or small wounds. Her body is fighting back with a very high fever, much too high for her to still be here.
Scenarios that use smallpox presuppose that someone is going to be able to get hold of it, someone who would use it. And those are scary scenarios, and I think they're real.
Unfortunately, the cultivation of smallpox and the formulation of biological weapon based on smallpox is relatively simple and straightforward. It's one of the simplest production processes in terms of biological weapon.
In Kiev, Ukraine, a new era is dawning, even if it doesn't show at first glance. An American pharmaceutical company plans to cater to affluent patients with ultra-modern diagnosis centers and medications to improve immune system response. Company president Ken Alibek was formerly known as Kanatian Alibekov, the deputy chief of Biopreparat, the secret biological warfare program the Soviet Union maintained well into the 90s, ignoring all signed treaties. The Kazakh native supervised 32,000 Biopreparat employees. The program produced enough weapons to kill the world's population several times over, including bubonic plague, smallpox, Ebola, and genetically modified high-tech viruses. Alibek has switched loyalties in every respect since that time. He defected to the US and traded his knowledge for consulting fees. Now he wants to give the human immune system a helping hand against cancer, the aging process, and bioterror.
There is no single virus which cannot be used as a virus for bioterrorism or for biological weapon. Unfortunately, that's the case. How they can be grown or how they can be developed, I have, let me say, my strong, let me say, internal resistance to explain it.
We know that the Soviet Union bioweapons research program produced roughly 100 tons of smallpox viruses in solution. That is enough to fill up four large tank trucks. They took that fluid with smallpox and put it in thousands of small pipettes and froze it or placed the samples in refrigerators. Officially, these stocks were destroyed.
Offiziell sind diese Mengen vernichtet worden.
In early 90s, it was a desperate time. The institute had no running water, no money to pay salary to people, and people essentially sold everything, whatever they had in the lab, just in order to get some money and survive.
Schmidt here. Meine Freundin hat hohes Fieber, 39,5, hat starken Schwindel, sie kann kaum noch laufen, hat grippeartige Symptome und einen komischen Ausschlag hat sie.
Irgendwie wie Windpocken,
nur anders. Ich bin Medizinstudent. Meine Freundin war länger in Zentralafrika. Ich mache mir wirklich Sorgen. Ja.
Lukas Schmidt?
The day after the exam, none of the flatmates in Dortmund are making any connections between the Congress in Berlin and the peculiar rash rising on Sammy's skin. The rash is the outward manifestation of her body's immune system response. 11 days after the initial infection, an army of smallpox viruses have worked their way up to her skin cells. Sammy's bloodstream is already inundated with deadly pathogens, and her immune cells are on red alert. Her heart is racing to try and kill off the invaders with fever, but this invasion can no longer be stopped. Increasing numbers of cells are falling victim to the attack. The chemical alarm signals are already flooding Sammy's bloodstream. Smallpox viruses are particularly dangerous because they crack the epithelial cells, the vital cells that cover all of our organs and vessels. They also cover our body with skin. Using chemical messengers, the attackers take command and force the body's cells to copy the DNA of the smallpox virus. Each cell does this several hundred thousand times before finally perishing. Still inside the cell plasma, the virus's self-assembly program awakens the DNA copies to life. The smallpox virus has another trick up its sleeve. It can move from cell to cell using the microscopically small spaces between them, avoiding the detour through the bloodstream. Sammy will only survive if her immune system quickly bombards the smallpox viruses with specially produced antibodies. The emergency physician is also suspicious about Sammy's pustules and her recent trip to Africa. He has her rushed to an isolation ward. Back in New York, the Berlin attack is having its first repercussions. In the meantime, virologist James Baldwin is a walking time bomb. With every kiss, with every breath, he's infecting those closest to him with the smallpox virus.
Did you have a good day today?
Yes.
Honey, you've got fever. Your head is completely hot.
I'm not feeling really too well, actually.
James was vaccinated against smallpox years ago, but his vaccine has failed, in part. He doesn't break out with a rash, but he's contagious nonetheless.
Will you do that? Yeah? I know it's very early, but go to bed now.
Yeah.
Good girl.
Good night, darling.
Night, Daddy.
What's wrong with you? Shall I call a doctor?
What?
Shall I call a doctor?
No, I'm fine.
The main bioterrorist, yeah, is not those few people that we suspect. Nature is the main bioterrorist, isn't it? Yeah, so in principle, when you look at what has happened in the last decade, yeah, we have HIV, AIDS, we have SARS, we have influenza, we have pox virus outbreak. I can go on forever. Yeah, so all the time, new niches, yeah, are being formed for new viruses, in most cases to escape from the animal world and to target humans.
There are most certainly viruses lurking in the rainforest that could eliminate mankind. For sure, there's some virus out there, simply because the number of them is so great, that would be able to erase all humankind.
Brazilian virologist Luis Pereira has been in close jungle combat for 25 years. During his expeditions into Valo de Ribeira in the state of Sao Paulo, Brazil, he battles an invisible enemy with bird nets, mosquito tents, and mouse traps. Pereira has gotten into the ring with the Rosiovirus, the rare Sabia virus, the dengue virus, and always lethal arena viruses. A lab accident with the Guaratuba virus almost killed him. But Pereira keeps trying to trap the next enemy before it strikes. He's already discovered 30 new viruses. Deep in the rainforest, Pereira and his team never know what they'll come across. They tranquilize and examine nothing but rodents, but must wear protective suits and respirators. Pereira is constantly finding the Hunter virus in mice. This virus doesn't affect the rodents, but it can be deadly to humans. The Hunter virus has little use for us. We just happen to cross the virus's path by advancing further into the rainforest and destroying the habitats of its original host animals. In countless cases, animals and their viruses have lived in peaceful coexistence for millions of years. But when the same virus jumps over to humans, they suddenly turn deadly.
A onça pelo tamanho, né? Pela força.
We're afraid of the jaguar because of its size and its strength. But the danger mice pose is invisible, almost invisible. They come in during the night and normally eat, evacuate, and urinate. This creates an aerosol of viral particles that contaminate people without them even knowing that the mice had been in their homes. That's why I'm more afraid of a field mouse, because we don't see the harm it causes to humans.
In Franceville, Gabon, in Central Africa, researchers are hunting another spectacular killer, Ebola. More than anywhere else in the world, people in the tropics are under grave threat from zoonoses, the viruses that jump from animals to humans. Just like HIV, which entered the human population almost 100 years ago, a number of new viruses are taking a run-up. For the first time, French virologists at the Medical Research Unit in Gabon have discovered Ebola particles and antibodies in three species of bats. Xavier Pourou and his colleagues suspect that every outbreak of Ebola originates from bats. There are a series of lethal viruses dormant in bats: Marburg, SARS, Hendra, or rabies, just to name a few. Every one of them has the potential to cause the next catastrophe.
The Ebola virus is so spectacular because it strikes so quickly. The epidemics are very rare. There have only been 16 outbreaks over a period of 30 years. But every outbreak has had an extremely high fatality rate, and we still know very little about the transmission of the virus.
Up to now, an illness like Ebola has only impacted very limited groups of 150 to 300 people, with outbreaks in the Congo, in Gabon, and in Uganda, all of which we were able to contain. But we mustn't forget that HIV started this way as well, as a virus that was transmitted from chimpanzees to humans. And today, with HIV, we have a worldwide pandemic with millions of infected people.
Des millions de cas.
Eleven days after the smallpox attack, Sami Mahali is rushed to hospital in Dortmund in a quarantine ambulance. The pustules on her skin are as infectious as her every breath. Over the coming days, Sami will be treated by fully protected doctors and nurses in a controlled negative pressure station. Only vaccinated personnel are allowed to approach her without a protective suit. There is still no effective treatment for smallpox.
The disease is very scary. The disease is ugly. Changes, mutilates people, changes their appearance, and is able to produce a huge panic.
Sammy's flatmate Nila gets vaccinated that same day, but Lucas suffers from atopic dermatitis. The smallpox vaccination can have deadly side effects for persons with allergies. Lucas and Neely must also be quarantined, just like everyone who's had contact with Sammy. 5 days later, Sammy is struck by the complete manifestation of smallpox. Even if she survives, she'll be disfigured by scars. A week later, the deadly rash appears in New York. James Baldwin's wife Helen and their daughter Marla have fallen ill.
Hello, is this 911? Yeah, please help me. I've got a daughter and my wife is extremely sick. I don't know. My wife has a fever. She has spots on her face. She has a rash on the side of her neck. Yes, please. The corner of 54th and 3rd Street, Lower Manhattan. I don't know. I mean, she's not talking to me. She's not saying anything. I just want to... Okay. Thank you. Helen, talk to me, please. Helen, please, off, please. I don't know what to do for you unless you talk to me.
I'm not feeling good.
What? Jesus Christ.
We have eradicated the smallpox virus and fortunately vaccinations are no longer needed. In fact, it is the first time in human history that a disease has been completely defeated. And ironically, this is now our special Achilles heel because we are no longer immune to it.
Like smallpox, Ebola also belongs to the dirty dozen of fatal pathogens that might be used as biological weapons. Every Ebola outbreak in Africa shows why. Ebola kills quickly, bleeding people to death. In September 2007, the virus struck in the Congo. Initially, all indications pointed to a diarrhea epidemic. But after 80 deaths, alarm bells were ringing. Doctors Without Borders sent the first specialists and set up a quarantine ward in Kampungu, only 100 miles from Kananga, a city of over 1 million. Technical staff built a landing strip and roads for emergency operations. Danish doctor Christian Fabiansen was the first physician on the scene.
This particular lady has tiredness, fatigue, general symptoms, abdominal cramps, nausea and vomiting.
Fabiansen's patient was only identified as an Ebola case from the final test results a few days later. She became ill while caring for her Ebola-infected daughter. Indicated by her reddened eyes, the destruction of her blood vessels has already started. Through a wound or mucous membrane, the filiform killer entered her bloodstream. Like every virus, it is programmed to replicate itself in specific target cells. The target coordinates for the tiny, coiled Ebola just happen to lead to the immune system's scavenger cells. It forces the infected cells to produce a myriad of copies of the virus and to transport them as stowaways to almost every nook and cranny of the body. Finally, Ebola kills the immune cells and thus does an end run around the immune system. Hundreds of thousands of viruses burst out of the infected scavenger cells everywhere in the patient's body. The Ebola virus's second specialty is destroying the cells that make up blood vessel walls, thus ripping holes in the smallest of veins. When Ebola finally progresses into the lymph nodes and spleen, there is very little hope left. The lymph nodes of this patient are already severely afflicted. There is no cure or therapy for Ebola. And after just a few days, the victim bleeds to death internally.
Bleeding begins a few days after onset of the illness. Outward signs can include nosebleeds, bleeding from the mouth, or blood in vomit or in diarrhea. Those infected die about 5 to 8 days after onset of the illness in 80% of the cases.
80% des cas.
From the lab confirmed cases we had inside the isolation ward, a little more than 70% died from the infection. So that's the reality. A lot of your patients will die in that setting with that disease.
Perhaps there will be a new Ebola tomorrow, a less fatal strain. The sick will still be able to travel and carry Ebola into the cities and cause panic.
In the scenario, the smallpox viruses have caused a worldwide epidemic 3 weeks after the attack in Berlin. Each sick person infects two-thirds of the unvaccinated people they have come into contact with. Although there are just a few hundred infected persons in more than 30 countries, the panic outbreaks are almost uncontrollable. Entire hospitals are put under quarantine and armed guard. In New York, Marla Baldrin is also in an isolation ward with her mother, Helen. By now, the World Health Organization assumes a bioterror attack is on their hands. Congress attendees like James Baldrin have become involuntary accomplices to the crime. Every vaccinated person whose protection fails can become a walking time bomb. Recalling every human contact over the past weeks can now help save lives.
Yeah.
Where else did you go over the last 2 days with your wife? Did you go to the cinema together? Did you go to the theater?
Last Tuesday in Lower Manhattan, we saw a show. We sat in the front row. There were people everywhere. There's, you know, it was five people next to us here. We had 400 people behind us. I mean, I don't know their names. I don't know where they're from or how old they are.
We'll find them out. We can contact them. Do you normally take your daughter to school?
I don't. I mean, I drive my car, you know, I park right out the front of the elementary school.
James Baldrin isn't the only one suffering the terrible certainty of having infected his wife and daughter without falling ill himself.
When you consider that how much we invest in military defense, you know, even in Europe, you know, for the likelihood that someone's going to come across the border and invade us, and you think that the real invaders are little microbes that are crossing our borders every day, and you compare how much we're investing in our national security, well, you really have to ask the question, is our security at some nominal border, or is it security the health of our population and the vulnerability of that health status?
In late summer 1999, there was a strange bird die-off in New York City. Countless animal cadavers were collected. The news of several deaths among citizens alarmed the health authorities in the mega metropolis. All of the victims showed signs of changes in their brains caused by massive inflammation. And the victims had just one other thing in common. All spent quite a bit of time outdoors during the summer. After a few false reports, the pathogen was identified. The mosquito-borne West Nile virus, a virus that had never been seen in the US. There were rumors of a bioterror attack, but it was probably much less spectacular.
The virus is quite common in North Africa. For example, it is found frequently in Israel. And there's a huge Jewish community in New York that is, of course, constantly flying back and forth between Tel Aviv and New York. It is fairly likely that it came to America on a scheduled flight, possibly first class and certainly air-conditioned.
Thomas Breezer was the man who initially unmasked the West Nile virus. The German scientist is considered one of the world's foremost virus investigators. With a three-step high-tech analysis in his New York lab, he can detect almost any pathogen, even if he has no idea what exactly he's searching for. He discovered a whole family of new cold viruses, exposed an unknown virus fatal to bees, and an arenavirus that killed transplant patients in Australia. He was also on the front lines of battle against SARS. But despite Breezer's brilliant detective work exposing the West Nile virus, it conquered all of America except Alaska and Hawaii.
That was one of the lessons of this outbreak. Even in a highly industrialized country where everything needed is available, helicopters, insecticides, it was not possible to stop or eradicate the spread of a virus epidemic that was recognized relatively early on.
Mosquitoes are the jet fighters of the virus empire. Brazilian virus hunter Luis Pereira is constantly capturing them for analysis. They transmit countless pathogens like West Nile, chikungunya, yellow fever, and dengue, also called breakbone fever due to the pain it causes during the first infection. But now there are four different strands of the dengue virus. The second dengue infection with any of the other strands isn't just painful, it's fatal. As with Ebola, the victims die from internal bleeding after just a single mosquito bite.
When dengue started circulating in Brazil, it was just dengue. So the people who had dengue would feel bad, prostrate, but didn't have hemorrhagic dengue. After that came type 2, and now more recently, with the introduction of dengue 3, we're having many cases of hemorrhagic dengue in almost all of Brazil.
On the 24th day after being infected, Sammy Mahali dies of organ failure. For those without vaccinations, smallpox is fatal in 30 of 100 cases. Sammy is the first of 165 victims around the globe. Her boyfriend Lucas has also taken ill. Prone to allergies, he refused the vaccination because of the potentially fatal side effects. Just one of the Dortmund flatmates got away with nothing more than a terrible fright. Nearly Novak responded well to the vaccination.
We don't know how to treat viral diseases by specific drugs. In many cases, the specific means, the specific therapeutic treatments do not exist. In the case of many viral diseases, very dangerous diseases, the only treatment is just supportive therapy.
Why is there no vaccine against Ebola? Yeah, why is there no vaccine and against a number of those infections that we do not see here? Because we do not consider them a priority. So when we want to change the world, you know, it's not just for flu, it is not just for SARS, but it's a much bigger problem, and we have to face that collectively.
Nathan Wolfe has been searching for deadly viruses in Cameroon for 9 years, both in the blood of local population and the animals they hunt. The virologist from Los Angeles has a dream to stop the next AIDS before it starts somewhere beneath the green canopy of the rainforest. Today, all virologists share the same certainty that the next killer virus will be a zoonosis, a disease that jumps from animals to humans. Perhaps a hunter somewhere will infect himself while carving up his prey. From there, it's just a short hop to the next city, hotel bar, and airport. That's why Wolf maintains a worldwide network of virus forecasting stations. Three of them are in Africa, three in Asia. One month after the bioterror attack in Berlin, mass smallpox vaccinations are taking place in 39 countries. Germany is one of the few countries to have enough vaccine stocks for all of its citizens. But the inoculation is only effective up to a maximum of 4 days after the initial infection. There is a strict vaccination plan. Those who carry out essential public services get the vaccine first: police officers, health personnel, lorry drivers. But the locations of the vaccine storage facilities are kept secret, out of fear of looting. In Dortmund, one of the best prepared major cities in Germany, along with Berlin, Munich and Frankfurt, 120,000 people must be vaccinated each day. Everyone in line knows, the longer the waiting time, the higher the risk.
Ja, wo willst du denn hin? Stand hier auch schon. Ja, wir waren noch zweieinhalb Stunden.
With 15 needle pricks, the vaccination serum enters the human body. The serum contains vaccinia viruses, a relative of the harmless cowpox virus that was used in 1796 as a vaccination, when no one knew viruses even existed. In order to enter a cell, vaccinia viruses camouflage themselves as waste that is normally absorbed by the neighboring cells without alarming the scavenger cells of the immune system. Just like its deadly relative, the vaccinia virus also reprograms the infected cells with chemical messengers and compels them to produce around 10,000 copies of its DNA within 6 hours. The first cells succumb to the virus's attack no later than 24 hours after the vaccination. But the vaccine is dosed in such a way as to ensure the damage remains localized. 4 to 5 days after the vaccination, a single pustule appears at the injection site. The scar that it leaves behind will remain for a lifetime. Just like the immune system's learning process, the antibodies against vaccinia now work against all pox viruses, including the deadly variola maya. Cancer-afflicted mice in Professor Schalai's lab at the University of Würzburg have also been injected with vaccinia viruses. But the researchers have genetically manipulated these viruses and equipped them with a luminescent protein. Thanks to this, any cluster of viruses in the mouse can be tracked down with special cameras. The viruses injected on the tail hide from the immune system in the mouse's cancerous tumor cells, thus making the tumors and metastasis visible. But the most amazing result from this study is that viruses also completely devour the tumors from within. Hungarian-born Aladár Schalai and his team at Würzburg will soon be testing this technique on human patients.
Das scheint jetzt so zu sein,
It seems that we now have a living organism that can detect tumors, whether they are located at the surface or within deep tissue. It can also treat tumors and allows us to track the therapeutical process non-invasively. This will be wonderful if it works in humans. It would be of tremendous benefit to cancer patients.
Viruses are very efficient in bringing genetic material to cells of humans, for instance, but for instance also to cancer cells. Yeah? So we could indeed use viruses to our advantage in the future by using them as vectors to actually bring certain packages of genetic material that we want to use to combat certain diseases like cancer.
At Bigelow Lab in Maine in the US, researchers are using viruses to combat bacteria that infect the famous local lobster. After the bacteria are dispatched, the viruses disappear as well. English scientist Susan Warham hopes this will replace the use of antibiotics in aquafarming of lobster and crab. Her colleague Willie Wilson discovered a virus that doesn't fit into our distorted image of silent killers at all. In the water samples he takes every day, he finds up to 10 billion viruses in 1 litre of seawater. No one knows what they're good for, except for one. EHV86 is Scotsman Willie Wilson's favourite virus. EHV86 is the vegetarian among viruses, specialising in the single-celled phytoplankton Emiliana huxleyi. The virus slips between the calcite discs on the algae's surface into the cell interior. Like all viruses, EHV86 forces its victims to copy the virus genes. One gene on the viral DNA is there solely to release ceramides, a chemical substance that can also be found in face creams. EHV86 uses the ceramides to prolong the life of the cell, so it can produce more virus copies before dying. But even the death of the algae has a good side, the gas. Dimethyl sulfate is released as it decomposes. It is this gas that gives the sea the typical scent that we recognize as the smell of the ocean. When it rises further up into the atmosphere, it accelerates cloud formation. An invisible virus is thus responsible for saving the climate on our planet. The die-off of Emiliana huxleyi algae can, amazingly enough, even be observed from space by satellites.
Now, I like to think of viruses as lubricants. And if you use that analogy if you don't put a lubricant in your car, you don't put oil into your car is just going to seize up. Now, in the ocean, the same thing is going to happen. If there was no viruses there, the whole system would just seize up. What would happen? There'd be no loss processes. So all the bacteria and the algae, they would just keep growing and growing and growing, and you would end up with just an ocean of sludge. You'd be able to walk in the ocean even.
We tend to think of viruses as negative entities, but that is almost certainly sort of like the drunk looking for their keys under the lamppost. It's just, if you only look for nasty viruses, those are the viruses you're going to find.
There is palpable relief this morning at WHO in Geneva. The number of 596 infected persons around the world has remained steady for the first time since the crisis began. The smallpox pandemic appears to have been stopped. In this scenario, the attack in Berlin claimed 165 deaths. One of the victims is Helen Baldwin. Her daughter Marla will survive.
I
course, the viruses are they are an enemy, yeah, but they are part of the whole system. Yeah, so they are included in the whole ecological system. So they're part of the whole thing, and sometimes they get out of control. But in most cases, they get out of control when we get out of control.
Every year, at least one new pathogen attacks humankind. Almost all of them come from animals. Whenever a virus changes hosts, it can be deadly. HIV, the bird flu, SARS, and Ebola are simply the most famous zoonoses to date.
This is Epomox franchetti, one of three species of bats in which we detected antibodies against Ebola.
38 new zoonoses were discovered in the past 25 years alone. Global warming and environmental destruction forced animal species and their pathogens into new habitats. Humans have never been exposed to such an onslaught of viruses.
Animal agents have been jumping into human populations as long as we've been forever. Okay, but what's changed is that these jumps suddenly have the capacity to, they've got the fuel in terms of population density, they've got the connections that allow them to spread. And so the potential that these things can actually grab on and hold on in this new sort of incredible niche that human populations are. I mean, we would also represent this vast sort of energetic resource to microorganisms. If you can adapt to humans, it's like winning the sort of microbial lottery.